Well, welcome this morning to Waypoint. We are glad to have you here, and we are glad that you are here with us to worship God this morning. We're going to continue worshiping God through the singing, and we're going to sing the song, Hosanna, Praise is Rising.
Thank you. Amen. And you may be seated. And we're going to go into a time of prayer right now. And you've watched the news. You know what's going on. And hurricane disasters and wildfires, an earthquake in Mexico, and just so much going on. And before we pray, I was having a conversation just before service, I think with Bob, and how many people would be affected that we know of? And so I'm wondering, just as we head into prayer time, by show of hands, how many people know somebody who has been directly affected by one of these hurricanes or natural disasters here recently? And this is a large touch in our church. And so we're gonna do our prayer time. We're gonna take this opportunity and this gift that we have to bend the ear of God and to bring our prayers and petitions before Him. So let's bow our heads and let's pray just as He has asked and even called us to do. Father in heaven, Lord, you are holy. You are wonderful, and God, you are amazing. Lord, thank you that you call us to bring our prayers and petitions before you. God, we care a lot about what's going on, and we have loved ones directly impacted, and we know of people and stories going on. Lord, we bring these prayer requests to you, knowing that so many have suffered this past week or so, knowing that there's Hurricane Irma going on right now in Florida. And Lord, we, by prayer and petition, we pray for the people in the path of this hurricane. God, we pray for all those who have been affected through these natural disasters. And Lord, in this broken and fallen world, Lord, we plead with you that you would step in. And Lord, just as we sang about your presence and this amazing concept and this amazing, wonderful gift that we have of your presence, we pray, God, that your presence would be experienced by all of those hurting and scared and struggling. Lord, we just we pray that you would wrap your arms around them, keep them safe, and Lord, draw them closer to you. Lord, empower us as a church. We thank you so much for this call that you've placed on us to be a light to the world. And God, we know that there are countless opportunities for us to do this. And so, Lord, our prayer as a church is that you would help us to keep this focus. God, give us wisdom in the partnerships that we have, in the ways that we seek to help out. We can only do so much, but God, just like what you've done with the loaves and the fish, God, you multiply our efforts. And so, Lord, bless us as a church and as individuals in the ways that we seek to help and to shine brightly for you. And so, Lord, we pray all this, and God, we know that there's also hurts just within this church body. And so, Lord, we lift up those prayer requests in those situations which you know far better than any of us. And so, Lord, we bring them and we place them at your feet and we pray, God, that you would move. God, thank you for this chance to come together as brothers and sisters and to talk with you, our Lord, our God, our leader. Lord, lead us and bless us in this service today. And God, it's in Jesus' name we pray all of this. Amen. Amen. It's a powerful thing to pray and to be able to bring these prayer requests to God, and we seek to be a part of the solution. And so I want to mention to you a couple announcements, and I want to ask the ushers to come forward at this time as we worship God through the giving of our gifts and tithes and offerings. But as they do, I want to share with you a couple key opportunities, because it's so vital that we pray, because prayer is powerful. God calls us to, and God can do immeasurably more than all we could ever ask or imagine. But we also know that our faith needs to have action with it, that faith without works is useless, it's dead. And so we look for ways to put our faith into action. And so I just want to highlight some opportunities through our partners, and obviously with these hurricanes hitting the U.S. and other countries and other areas, this is on our mind. One of our partners is DRAW. D-R-A-W stands for Disaster Relief at Work. And we've been in contact with Greg Martin, our friend there. And Greg's been here at Waypoint to share what he does. And been in contact with him and ways we can help out. And some of you guys help volunteer. And there's a volunteer opportunity this Wednesday. And just watch for more details. You can check them out on Facebook and beyond. Follow the link from our website. But be involved. Because we have this opportunity to put our faith in action in this way and to help people in these disasters. So Greg is asking for help in volunteering, and there's lots of ways to help out. And you guys, and through Waypoint, we've been able to give a check for $1,500 for supplies and relief, and we hope to give even more. So if you'd like to do that, you can give online through us and just note it for local, regional, or otherwise you can give directly to drawbuckets.com. And help those guys out as they seek to minister. Also, as part of Free Methodists, the Free Methodist denomination, our bishops, our highest level of leadership, has a Bishop's Relief Fund, and they've been very, very active in Hurricane Harvey and will be with Irma. So if you'd like to donate, that's a way. You can contact the church office, and we'll steer you in the right direction. Wanted to highlight a couple of studies starting up, and this is kickoff time. We got a lot of announcements, but this is exciting because there's so much going on. So, Kathy, are you available to come on up here? Hey, this is great. Hey, sweet. How you doing, buddy? Hey, good, and better now.
Better, good.
Oh. Yeah, now that you're right here.
Oh, it's so sweet.
Did you see
so
what
sweet.
I did there?
I haven't seen him in a while. I got to be careful. Okay, the ladies' Monday morning Bible study is going to be beginning actually a week from tomorrow. However, tomorrow we're inviting all the ladies who may be interested to please come for a meet and greet. We'll greet you and welcome you and give you an overview of what the studies are going to look like throughout the year. There should be coffee and munchies, I think, which is always sweet.
Can
good,
I come?
Sure.
Sweet.
Yeah, if you can put up with all of the ladies, you'll be bothered.
It's a fun group.
Yeah,
that
fun
is a
group.
Very fun group.
So tomorrow morning at 9:30, we would invite, it makes no difference, age, just if you're available, just show up. It's a wonderful opportunity to get to know new people. We get to study the Word. I believe the first study, which will begin the following Monday, is going to be from Lisa Harper on the book of Mark. So that should be a really, really good study. Usually it's a DVD series with a workbook. And believe me, don't worry about the homework. Even though there is homework, don't worry about it, because sometimes even those of us that think we should do homework don't necessarily get it all done. But anyway, it's a great opportunity for the women of the church to get together and meet and greet. And so show up tomorrow morning at 9:30 and see what it's all about.
Amen. Thanks so much, Kathy. Yeah, looking forward to it. And you guys, again, we believe very strongly that everybody needs an opportunity to grow in their faith and to be in a small group or to be in a small group of people to grow together. So Mavis Sturgis is our small groups coordinator, and we've got so many things popping up this fall and beyond. So if you're interested in being in a small group, contact the church office or contact Mavis directly. Savannah Woods, are you able to come on up here? Hey, this is really cool. You guys have heard about this. And this opportunity is imminent. It is right around the corner. Yes.
All right. So I'm sure you've all heard about the 5K that we're planning to help one of our partners in India, the Umri Christian Hospital. They are building a new ICU, neonatal ICU, a maternity ward. And I had a board meeting this week, and they are putting the finishing touches, just putting the windows in the buildings, and then they'll be ready to go, except for they don't have any equipment. And so they need funds to buy all the equipment, from beds to ventilators and everything in between. So I'm hoping that this 5K can help to offset some of those costs. Do we have the slide? Is it working?
Maybe a slide.
No? Okay. That's okay. So it's September 30th. This Friday is the cutoff date to register if you want the free t-shirt. It's $30 for adults, $20 for teens, $5 for children. I do have my computer, so if you're like, I don't know how to register, I'll be out in the lobby between services after church. If you want help registering, just come find me. 10 a.m. on the 30th at Covenant Hills Camp. If you just want a t-shirt, they're a pretty cool design, $15 for the t-shirt. If you're like, I can't run, that's okay. There's a lot of us who are going to be there that can't run. We're going to walk it. And then if you just want to give money, that's always welcome as well.
Right on. I have a quick question
for
you. Okay, so Savannah sits on the board for this hospital in Asia, and that several of us have been to, and it's an amazing, amazing work. So I want to put you on the spot with a question.
Okay.
What's the best thing about the Umri Hospital?
Their mission. The hospital exists to serve the poor, and they just take their costs. They pretty much charge patients at cost for what the services are, and they're able to reach people who otherwise wouldn't have medical care. And then in their medical care, they also have a focus on Jesus. So every patient that comes by gets to meet with their chaplain, and they're really just reaching people for Christ just as much as they're healing the physical body. They're also healing the spiritual body. So that is a really cool thing to watch, and they always have incredible stories of miracles and God working, and it's just an exciting time for them because they're growing faster than we can keep up with them. Every board meeting that we have, we're like, that wasn't even on the 5-year plan, and they already have it done because they're just exploding right now. So it's an exciting time.
Yeah, right on. Dynamic area of the world, and it's a powerful thing when people who haven't met Jesus come to this hospital and have significant needs. And they're prayed over, the gospel is shared with them, and it has a powerful impact in this area of the world when you minister to body and to soul. Mm-hmm. So thanks, Savannah.
Thank you.
Be a part of that 5K. I'll snag that microphone. Thank you very much. Todd, come on up here, man. Thank you. Who's that? Man, serious props out there. You have a reputation.
Why didn't you laugh when Savannah came up here? I don't understand.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Hey, what's going on, buddy?
Nothing. What's going on with you?
Yeah, I always love having you up here to do announcements because it is always, it's never a dull moment.
Right. I know.
So, anyways, what's going on?
Yeah. So I'm up here for a couple of things. I talked to you guys last week about Asia trip. Similar to what
similar area,
same country. Can I say that? Okay. Anyways, we want to get together after the second service to have anybody that's interested in going just to talk through the times, the dates, and all that stuff. We actually potentially could have a group of women and men going together doing different things. So it's open to everybody to at least start the conversation and see if you guys are interested. The trip is in February. We would go out February 2nd at night and then return to Michigan February 12th or 13th. So that's kind of the time frame. So before you even come to the meeting, at least if you know that you could go and it's in the time frame of what you can take off work or be there, that's the time frame. So
yeah, we believe very strongly in these partnerships. This is an opportunity for us to be there, and this has benefited us. We had a leader from this area of the world here this summer and sharing about the ongoing things, and he and his wife were able to speak and build into us, and just wonderful partnership.
Right. So second thing is I don't have pictures for this because you told me not to put them up. The surprise that we've been talking about and been trying to push and stuff like that. You guys got to come back second service because I'm going to have some pictures. So, you know,
nudge.
Some pictures. Anyways, I'm going to need some help probably in the next couple weeks. I don't know the dates because I still have to get some concrete work. I got to put a form in the ground to be able to put up the structure. So,
do you need any help with that?
I need strength really more than anything. Well, I don't know if that's going to work or not. But the two pieces of the major structure, one weighs over 200 pounds, the other one's somewhere around the same weight. So I need to have somebody help me lift this stuff in place and so I can weld. So a lot of hands would help out instead of us having to, you know, break our backs and do it by ourselves or by me doing it. So, or in you.
Yeah, you would help me out, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So
anyways, just stop by and talk to me for a few minutes after second service before the meeting for Asia. Happens if you're interested, and I'll let you guys maybe get your numbers or whatever and call you when we know for what Saturday it's going to be. So, thanks. Hey, love you, bud.
Hey, you too, man. This went way better than I thought it would.
We too.
good stuff. And hey, one last thing I see in my notes is just, again, small groups. If you want to be involved with that, let us know, let Mavis know. Also in your bulletin, there's a little spot where you can scratch that out. Get it to me or somebody. And we'd love to help plug in. Also the red folders there. And if you don't mind just filling those out, let us know that you're here. Let us know any updated contact info or maybe one last thing. I've heard from several of you guys that you don't necessarily know that the church church sends out emails, and it could be a prayer request email. It could be an email on some different things going on church-wide and some happenings. It could be a really, really awesome note from the pastor that happens roughly once a week when he has time and stuff. So if you're interested in that, you can scratch that on that red red friendship folder, or put it on the bulletin, or email the office. We'll make sure you're in the loop on church email. So let us know about that. And I have a question for you guys as we start our message time. And this is kind of going to be a bit more interactive, if you will. But I'm going to toss out some labels or some things. And if you identify more with one group or another, would you mind raising your hand? So I mean, just a nice easy one to start with is Coke or Pepsi. So how many people are Coke fans? Coca-Cola, Coca-Cola Classic, and it's brands like, okay, how many people are Pepsi fans? And Mountain Dew and all the ones that come with Pepsi. Okay, so we have that. How many? Yeah, don't have fights break out because of this stuff and all that. How many people are our oldest in their family as far as birth order and all that stuff? The oldest kids right here. Okay, how many people are the youngest? Okay, all right. Should we leave out the middle ones? I mean, is that really is that really bad? how many middle people? Middle kids right here. All right. Okay, here you go. This is a bit more polarizing, more so, and all that stuff, but how many people are Michigan State fans? Yeah, okay, there it is, okay. And how many people are Michigan fans? Okay, there we go. And we can do that because it was a good day for both teams yesterday. Okay, social media question, and maybe this doesn't even apply to you. Okay, Instagram fans, how many people prefer Instagram? Okay, both. Thanks, guys, both of you guys for being here. How many people are Facebook fans? Okay, how many people are none of the above fans? Wow. So I won't plug our Waypoint Facebook page to this crew. Okay, Apple or Android? Okay, how many people are Apple iPhone fans? Right here, let's hear it. There you go. How many people are Android fans and enjoy their Android phones? Okay, one last one, okay? And okay, how many people are toilet paper over fans right here, okay? And how many of you are toilet paper under fans, okay? Shame on you guys. I don't want to say you're wrong, but what's the point, you know? All right, but you guys, we love our labels. We live in a world that gravitates towards labels for one reason or another. We just love, you know, saying, this is me, and you could list off five or six words, and you'd be able to fit into a stereotype that our culture has created. We love our labels, right? And so those are hopefully fairly easy and non-disruptive, if you will. But there, you know, if we were to talk about religious labels that exist, if we were to talk about ethnic labels that are placed on people, labels for education level. I mean, we love our initials after our name or whatnot. Politics separates so much of our culture, and it's so polarizing, the labels that come if you are a Republican or if you're a Democrat or even something else. There's labels that we put on, and that your location, if you're a Southerner or a Northerner or whatnot. I mean, we love labels for our diet. You know, this is who I am because of what I choose to eat, or this is who you are because of what you choose to eat. Sports you play. I mean, there's so many different labels that we put on each other, and some of this is really, really not healthy and not helpful, and it has an effect on the way that we view ourselves. And it has maybe an even bigger and more damaging effect on the way that we view each other, okay? And so I want to submit to you the greatest label that you should actually embrace, because how important it is and how important Scripture speaks on it again and again and again, and the cost for this label to be true about us. And this label is found in 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. And it says this, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God." And that is what we are. And this is a label that we should embrace. This is a label that we should own above all other labels, because none of that stuff matters anywhere near as much as the simple fact that I am a child of God, and you are too. This is a label that is helpful. And this is a label that supersedes any of those other damaging labels that can come in our lives. Because if we think about our earthly fathers, there can be good labels that come with that and damaging labels that come based on our own position with our earthly fathers. I mean, you could be born into riches. You could be born into power. You could be born into disgrace. Yeah, you could be born into abandonment or expectations, both low and high, just based on earthly father. But that doesn't matter compared to the fact that we are children of a heavenly Father who loves us so deeply that he gave his only son to die for us. So we're going to take a look at a passage in the Old Testament that really speaks on this to me. And this concept, we sang and we prayed about this concept that God is with us. And this is, our identity needs to be wrapped around this fact that we are children of God, and he isn't just a distant God, but he is a God who is with us. And so Moses, being one of the greatest leaders in Scripture, speaks into this in one of his conversations with God. And so to talk about this passage, we'll cover a little bit of background just hopefully very quickly. But back in the day with Moses, God had promised his presence to his people. And we see this throughout the book of Genesis. And God calls Abraham and he gives him promises. And one of the things is just his presence is going to be with his people. And this great phrase that exists throughout Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament, God says, "I will be their God and they will be my people." This is where our identity is tied up. This is where we embrace this concept. We are children of God and he is our God and we are his people. This is what we are known by. Not so much those other labels. This is what we are known by. And in the course of Israel's history, They became slaves in the land of Egypt, okay? But God, through his person Moses, and through miracles, demonstrates his power and sets his people free after hundreds of years of slavery. And so they leave Egypt. They actually are given gifts as they go and whatnot, and they go to seek out fulfillment of God's promises of land that they would possess and beyond, and God's presence with them. And so God was fulfilling his promise to Abraham and to his descendants. And the journey that we're going to read about is taking place to the promised land. And they've just left Egypt and they're in the wilderness. And on this journey, we see the Israelites' relationship with their heavenly Father, with God. And it's amazing God's patience that he has for all of us. I mean, myself included, example after example, and God's grace and God's forgiveness. But we see where the Israelites stumble even in their attitude of their hearts. And on the scale of the annoying, "Are we there yet?" comments, I mean, the Israelites were off the charts. Okay, and we read about this, Exodus 14, verse 11, while Pharaoh and his army were chasing after the Israelites, they complained and they said, "Hey, Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? I mean, what have you done by bringing us out of Egypt?" Well, you know, helped you establish your freedom as part of it and that, but yes, and then goes on. And after they get close to the promised land, they send spies. And after the report of the spies, Numbers 14:3 says, it describes what the Israelites said in their heart posture. "Why is the Lord bringing us into this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt?" Back to the glory days of being slaves and making bricks and working so hard under a slave master. There was a couple of rebellions that basically take place. Korah's rebellion, number 16. Isn't it enough that you have brought us out of a land flowing with milk and honey to kill us in the desert? I mean, we've read about what life was like in Egypt as slaves, and they call that a land of milk and honey? And to kill us in a desert? And now you want to lord it over us? After a shortage of water in Numbers 20, Israel said, why did you bring the Lord's community into this desert that we and our livestock should die here? Moses, why did you do this to us? Why is the Lord doing this? And just this heart posture of just resisting God's leading. But God, so faithful. And again, this is his people. And his presence was with them, okay? And there was a defining moment where Moses was up meeting with God. And we read about, in Exodus 32, a big mistake, a monumental mistake. And this, of course, is while Moses is up communing with God, hearing the law, the people reject the Lord. And they ask Aaron, if we gave you gold, would you build us an idol that we can worship? That we can thank for leading us out of Egypt and that will help lead us in the future? Could you do that for us? And Aaron says, yes, bring me your gold and your valuables and I'll put this together. And they constructed this idol and they worshiped it. And they took some of what the festivals that they were supposed to be doing, and they had a party, much like a festival that should be done for the Lord, and distorted it. And they rejoiced over this golden calf. And they had said, come, make us gods who will go before us. And this is what they thanked and what they wanted to go before them. And so you can imagine, from the Heavenly Father's point of view, after having so much grace and mercy and loving kindness for his people, what that would do to God who loves us so much. So verse 33, the Lord said to Moses, depart, go up from here, you and the people whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt, to land of which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, to your offspring I will give it. Basically, go. And I will send an angel before you. And I will drive out the Canaanites, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Go up to the land flowing with milk and honey. Okay? And this sounds, I mean, this sounds like a good thing, right? I mean, if you don't read on ahead, you see that God is saying, you know what? It's going to be done. I made this promise, and you know what? I'm going to send an angel. You guys will possess this land. Even after this betrayal, even after this hurtful thing that you've done to me, God says, I will drive them out. But where it hurts and where Moses, after fellowshipping with God, even talking with him face to face, where Moses hurts the most is the statement that God makes next. I'm going to do all this. I'm going to clear the way for you, and you'll have the land. But I will not go up among you, lest I consume you on the way, for you are a stiff-necked people. Basically, God said, you know what, Israelites, you guys will get the promised land. You guys will get there. I'll send an angel, it'll be taken care of, and you'll be able to enjoy that land flowing with milk and honey. That promise will be fulfilled, and you know what? Go enjoy. But I'm not going. That promise of I will be their God and they will be my people, I can't do it. You guys have rejected me, so I will let you reject me. Go to the promised land. It's yours. But I'm not going with you. The choices that we exercise in our freedom that God has given to us, they do have consequences as Israelites and as Moses were seen. Verse 12, this is so insightful into into how essential God's presence is for us. Because listen to what Moses, this great leader of the Israelites, listen to what he says to God as the next words. He says, Moses says to the Lord, "See, you say to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name, and you have found also found favor in my sight. Now therefore, if I have found favor in your sight, please show me your ways, that I may know you in order to find favor in your sight. Consider too that this nation is your people." And God said, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. I will give you this thing that you're asking for." And he, Moses, said to God, him, "If your presence will not go with me, do not bring us up from here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? Is it not in your going with us, so that we are distinct, I and your people, from every other person on the face of the earth?" Moses understands what's at stake. And in this conversation, Moses is saying, would you show me your ways? Would you be with me? Would you give me rest? Would you lead me? And then, God, if you don't come with us, don't send us. Moses understands what's at stake. God, we need you. It would be great to have that promised land that you describe, land flowing with milk and honey, that you would clear the way for. But God, if you aren't with us, don't send us, because it's not worth it. You see, Moses understood that God's presence in the Israelites' lives was everything. It was truly their identity. And without God being with them as their God and they as his people, nothing would be worth it. Even the greatest paradise, even the greatest riches, it wouldn't be worth it, because God's presence with us is everything. And this is why Moses pleaded in this way. And God, in his great grace, in his loving kindness, says this, "And the Lord said to his people," said to Moses, "This very thing that you have spoken, I will do, for you have found favor in my sight." And listen to what God, the creator of everything, says to this person, Moses. He says, "And I know you by name. You are mine. I love you. We have this fellowship, and my presence is with you." And this is God's promise for us. In this great peoplehood formula that exists again throughout Scripture, where God time and time reiterates to his people, "I will be their God and they will be my people." This is a promise that we embrace. This is our identity. Because here at Waypoint, I mean, we could do the greatest things in the community. We could help people out and all that. But if we aren't identified by the fact that God is with us, that we are Jesus' witnesses as we do this, what's the point? Because this is the very thing that identifies us, that is just part of who we are. And what we celebrate is our loving God is our Lord, our leader, our Heavenly Father. And whatever labels culture might try to put on us, it doesn't matter. Because God is our God, and we are identified as his children. The greatest identity I can ever have is that I am God's. And this is true for each one of us. Let's embrace that. I've shared with you guys this quote from Blaise Pascal, this great mathematician. I mean, revered as you take advanced mathematics. Blaise Pascal, if you're in a calculus class or anything like that, feel free to name drop Blaise Pascal, because it'll give you some street cred there. But Blaise Pascal, this great mathematician, says this wonderful phrase. And he says, "There is a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of every man which cannot be filled by any created thing, but only by God, the Creator, made known through Jesus. Okay? I mean, there's a God-shaped hole that we try to fill with all kinds of stuff in this world. Riches and titles and all those things. Sometimes we even try to fill it with labels and try to have our identity be the most important thing to us that the world gives us, those initials after our name, the power that you have or the authority that you're able to wield and those things. And sometimes we embrace that, but that doesn't fit that God-shaped hole that only our Heavenly Father, that our Creator instilled in every one of us. But when we embrace our Heavenly Father and we say, I embrace the fact that I am a child of God, this is my identity, that is the only way to fill that God-shaped hole. And so we live our lives in this way. Quick spot in Psalm 139, one of my favorite chapters of all of Scripture. But talks about God's presence with us. And David writes this, and he's speaking of God's presence, again, that we sang about today, that we prayed for, and that we embrace in Scripture. And David says this great fact, even as there's times in life where we say, you know what, I've messed up too bad. God's presence couldn't be with me. I've done the equivalent of what the Israelites did with the golden calf. I've strayed from God's commands in my life. How could God, my Heavenly Father, ever accept me back? David speaks of God's presence in our lives and the power of God's presence in this powerful passage of Scripture. Psalm 139, verse 7, he openly asks the question, where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? Basically, it's impossible to do because, verse 8, if I ascend to heaven, God, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol in the depths, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely, because of what I've done or otherwise, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light about me be night. Because of my circumstances, because of what I've done, the world is closing in on me. God, there's no hope that I can possibly see. Even in the darkest of darks, as described here, this is God's presence. Verse 12, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night, as we know it, when without streetlights and all that, when our eyes need to adjust after so much time and we still can barely make things out, even the darkest night, the night is bright as the day. For darkness is as light with you. And I love this these verses just resonating that nothing we can do can separate us from God's love. As our Heavenly Father, embrace this fact wherever you are at, as we kind of kick off this year, wherever you're at as an individual in your walk with God, there's nothing that God can't overcome through his grace and through his presence. And so our call today and tomorrow is as we go to school, as we go to work, as we fellowship, as we're in the community, as we go grocery shopping, as we're driving in the road, let's embrace the fact that God's presence is with us every moment of every day. And this is what defines us. Don't ever let anybody put a label on you that takes away from this fact and this wonderful promise that you are a child of God. Let's embrace our Heavenly Father today, tomorrow, and beyond. Let's pray. Father God, we love you so much. And God, we just want to pause and sit for a moment in your embrace. God, we know that you are right here with us. And we celebrate your presence because this and the fact that we are your children, this defines who we are. And God, you are able to take broken pieces in a broken life and a flawed and frail person. And God, you are able to lift us up as your children to do great things on your behalf. And so, Lord, my prayer is that you would lead us as a church. God, we are your children together. And God, we have this wonderful call where we can share your love with a world that needs it. Help us to do that. Help us to focus our efforts in the right ways, in the right places. Lord, help us to look for opportunities to show your love to a world that needs it. And Lord, bless us through the power of your Holy Spirit to do great things for your kingdom and for your glory. We love you, Father, Daddy, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great Sunday.